everyone. My name is Kristina Shuina, and I'm a journalist. And today with me, Roman Kern. Could you tell us please about yourself?
Yeah. So my name is Roman Kern. I'm from Austria, Graz, here. And I work on the Graz University of Technology, where I also lecture on NLP, natural language processing. So basically, I explain how ChatGPT is working. So currently, I have a ton of students being interested in that field. And also, in my second job, I'm working for the Know Center, which is a research organization specialized on making AI trustworthy.
Could you tell me, please, how did you decide that you want to work in this field?
Yeah, this is a lot of years ago when I was doing my PhD. I was interested in language, originally by improving search. Okay. I was thinking, because if you want to improve the search, it's helpful to understand what language are people using, and that got me interested. And got me also interested into how words relate to each other. So this was like concurrence analysis and how to represent language. And this is kind of the basis of language models as we know it today. Mm-hmm. Back then this was word-to-vec, and today we have like ChatGPT.
Okay. Could you tell me please about advantages and disadvantages? We know that it's a lot. Could you tell me like the main one?
Yeah, there's a ton of advantages and also some disadvantages that I have to mention, mm-hmm. of course. So big advantage here with this type of AI is that it's able to generate, okay. in this case for ChatGPT, generate text. It is capable of generating text which has not been there before. Mm-hmm. And you can control how the text looks like. So yeah. maybe you have so you want to write a story, and it's helpful that large language models, ChatGPT, are supporting you, giving you ideas or rephrasing sentences. Okay. So maybe you have a sentence you want to have it reworded, it, or you want to have something translated, do you want something to have summarized, you wanted to have something explained to you in detail. This is all some use cases that can be
the
use.
It's like the same, I'm from Russia, and I've seen one story from one Russian girl that she created due to ChatGPT, like a book with a lot of precepts or something like this, like from other countries and such. And she just like sell it, and she earns a lot of money from this. It's really cool. What kind of professions we can use for the future with AI?
Yeah, so this is certainly not an exhaustive list. So it's, I think that there's a ton of different professions being affected by this. There's even like a good paper that would recommend GPTs are not GPTs is kind of the title of that paper. And what they do is they analyze the tasks that are necessary for each job. And then, so really the drill down to the task level, and then see for each task whether it can be, presumably with ChatGPT and similar technologies, whether it can be improved by 50%.
Yeah.
And then they make a statement about different professions and how they are affected by this. And it's interesting to see what kind of professions are affected by this, because for instance, they also mentioned mathematicians might be affected in the future.
Okay. You also told me that like your students use it a lot. So could you tell me how it will be in the future? In, for example, what do we do, or what did you tell to your student that, okay, guys, stop it, or how we need to use it? Like, what you can recommend with? Because if you will use it, you will be fully, and also you will write your diploma with it, like a lot of like stuff. So what you can recommend for this?
So I tell the students to use it, mm-hmm. but frankly, okay. But I have to adapt. I have to adapt the exercises. I have to adapt the assignments and so forth. Yeah. And it's also important that students are aware of it. And when they use it, they should also make that clear. Yeah. So that's when they... And I think it's perfectly fine. So for instance, if you write your master's thesis or something like this, and then you use LLMs to improve the wording of things, that's perfectly fine. It's not okay to use these technologies in order to generate ideas for you.
Will the robot make a robot in the future?
Yeah.
Probably.
I usually don't make any statements about the future because we don't know, yes. Then again, the second question is what kind of is a robot? Yeah. But what I would rather foresee, if I would make a wild guess, or maybe it's not that wild actually, is that you have software writing software. Or AI models learning and training AI models. To which extent this also is then does this also apply to actual robots that interact in the physical world that that's to be seen. But yeah, if I would roll the dice on the answer, I would say probably yes.
Mm-hmm. But is it safety or not? Like right now, already we have a lot of news about that they took a lot of information from people and it's like private information. So what you can tell about is it well just...
Yeah, so since I mentioned I'm working on trustworthy AI, and this is a way to have an AI that conforms to certain criteria.
Okay.
So trustworthy AI comprises a lot of aspects,
yeah.
and privacy is one of these aspects. So if you want to use an AI that we consider trustworthy, it needs to conform to certain regulations that we see important. So protection of privacy, protection of sensitive information would be one. Next one would be fairness and discrimination, which also considers bias and so forth. So being aware what biases are in the data the AI has been trained on, what kind of biases are in the AI. We also have to see about like also safety, security, and this falls then back on technical level on robustness. Mm-hmm. So how the AI behaves if things change. Mm-hmm. And then also some aspects which are not that technical, but more societal well-being being one thing, and also risk management. Mm-hmm. So who is responsible if something breaks? Mm-hmm. So, and in the end, what we want to have is an AI that supports humans. And this is the final goal.
And then already in the future, how we will change like AI and what will be like correct? Do you know like some interesting ideas what we'll have in the future?
So it's hard to, again.
Maybe you have any researchers and you talked about like your PhD, maybe you don't know already something.
Yeah. So speaking of the future, what is expected to see, especially for LLMs, there are certain trends that we see. So the first trend will be going to multimodal. This is what they already see, that LLMs, traditionally speaking, are text-based, and now we see more integration of other modes like photos, videos, but we also see applications in time series data, for example, where LLMs work surprisingly well. Another trend that we see is that LLMs, what I said, are hallucinating, and they give wrong answers. So we see like simple mathematical questions they can't answer properly, but we can train them to use a calculator. This is then called a tool-augmented LLM.
Yeah.
So an LLM learns to use either tools or learns to use some APIs, basically to outsource, quote-unquote, some specific task. Mm-hmm. This is another trend that we see right now.
Okay. And the last question. We had Deep Blue funded by IBM. We had AlphaGo funded by Google. What is the future?
That's an interesting thing, because what I'm also very much interested in is it's open source or open weights large language models. There's another trend that we are currently witnessing. So most of the LLMs we talk about are from these big tech companies.
Okay.
Yeah. But there's, for instance, one tech company that goes a different path, and that is Meta, Facebook. What they did is kind of interesting. So they released a large language model, but under a very permissive license. So it's called Llama and Llama 2.
Okay.
It's quite competitive large language models, I would say. And these are open for researchers to use. You can fine tune them, you can work with them, you can integrate them into your own applications and so forth. And we now see more and more of these open weight models being released.
Sure. Thank you so much.